أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات كانت لهم جنات الفردوس نزلا خالدين فيها لا يبغون عنها حولا قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنفد البحر قبل أن تنفد كلمات ربي ولو جئنا بمثله مددا قل إنما أنا بشر مثلكم يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا صدق الله العلي العظيم The Holy Quran tells us that the first responsibility of man on earth is to establish justice and uphold justice and support justice. This is his or her first priority, first responsibility, and first task on earth. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. This is in Surah Al-Hadid. We have sent prophets and messengers and apostles, and we sent with them scriptures, divine scriptures, so people would live up to justice, stand up for justice, uphold justice. And tonight we speak about one of the global, universal pioneers of justice in the history of mankind. And that is Al-Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam. Today, human societies are suffering. Wherever you turn your face, be it an Islamic country, be it a non-Islamic country, be it in the Middle East, in the Far East, in Africa, in Asia, in Europe, in North America, we suffer from something called the lack of justice. We suffer from something called oppression and injustice within the human societies. And we learn from someone who stood for justice and gave his life for justice and advocated justice throughout 63 years of his fruitful and a blessed life. We learn from him how to stand with those who have been oppressed. In his last will, before his death, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam, he gives a direction, a directive to his children, to his family members who have gathered around his deathbed. He says, وَكُونَا لِلظَّالِمِ خَصْمًا وَلِلْمَظْلُومِ عَوْنًا. My will to you is that you always be an antagonistic to the oppressor, any oppressor, regardless of his or her color. When you see someone wreaking havoc, when you see someone usurping people's rights, when you see someone abusing someone else, whether that person is a dictator, is a leader of a country, or a father in a family, or a member of a community, wherever you see injustice, stand against it. وَكُونَ لِلظَّالِمِ خَصْمًا. خَصْم. Stand in his face. Do not allow that person to continue his injustice. This is the message of Ali ibn Abi Talib. This is the message of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the message of Islam and the message of Quran. Walil mazlumi auna, and be a supporter to an oppressed person or an oppressed community. Support them in whatever means you can afford. Do not look at people's colors or financial status or nationalities. If you find someone being oppressed and abused, stand with that person. Stand with that person. We have injustice everywhere. Today we have injustice being committed by ISIS against innocent people in many countries. ISIS are killing Muslims and non-Muslims, Shias and Sunnis, believers and non-believers, Arabs and non-Arabs, Middle Easterns, Europeans, Americans, Africans are being tortured, abused by ISIS. We have to raise our voice. Today, we stand at an important juncture. Some Muslims, unfortunately, support ISIS. They say they have a legitimate cause. They are establishing the Islamic Caliphate. I want to know what sort of Caliphate is this that barbarically slaughters people left and right? What sort of Caliphate is this that takes women as captives, prisoners, from one country and then they transfer them into another country to sell them in the market like commodities? They sell free women in the market. What sort of Islamic Caliphate is this where no religious institution, no temple, no mosque, no church is immune from the evil of this Caliphate? They kill people in the market streets, on the beach, inside the mosque, in the schools, in the hospitals. What sort of Islamic Caliphate is this? Islamic Caliphate means that the leader, the caliph, represents the manners, the akhlaq, the tradition of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet Muhammad, Allah says to him, O Muhammad, your main task, your main job is to protect people, the dignity of the people. We have sent you as mercy for mankind. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, to all people, not only the Muslims. You are a source of love, a source of forgiveness and compassion and appreciation for mankind. Prophet Muhammad did not kill innocent people. Prophet Muhammad did not take women as captives. He did not demolish places of worship. Prophet Muhammad, when he sent the Muslim troops to defend Islam, he will advise them, do not uproot a tree. Do not demolish a building. If someone is being wounded or injured, save his or her life. Do not hurt women or children. Only those who are in combat, those who lead aggression against you. This is the wording of the Quran. وَقَاتِلُوا الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ, stand in the face of those who fight against you, who wants to eliminate you, to defend yourself. وَقَاتِلُوا الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ, only those who are in combat, who carry weapons to kill you, to murder you. وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا, beyond that, do not transgress. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ. Do not transgress. That was the will, that was the advice of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet Muhammad was a pro-life, not a pro-death. Was a pro-building, not pro-destruction. Pro-unity and forgiveness, not a pro-division and takfir and excommunicating people from Islam. Some people will come to him and say, I'm a Muslim, although inside them they are not real Muslims. Still he will accept them. He will accept them, knowing that they are not real Muslims, but since they confessed with their tongue that I'm a Muslim, I'm a believer, he welcomes them. He would embrace people. He would encourage people to get closer to God. He would introduce them to God through love, not through sword, not through what ISIS and Saudi Arabia is doing, and some Gulf states are doing, who are supporting ISIS. So we have to stand against the oppressors. You have to raise your voice. Imam Ali, his message is the message of universal justice, justice for all. You should not just sit and relax if your family is immune from aggression, if your family is okay and they enjoy their shelter and their food. If there are other people who are suffering, you should not feel okay. You should feel their pain. This is the universal message of Islam. Today when Yemen is being bombed by those, I would not say camel riders, because this is a promotion, donkey riders, sending their fighters, jet fighters, during the month of Ramadan, the holiest time, where people should find peace and nearness to God. They send their missiles and their weapons and their jet fighters to bomb the poorest country on earth, the Yemeni people. You know, now Yemen, according to the United Nations, is on the verge of huge catastrophe. Starvation, real starvation. People who have no food, who have no medicine, their children, their women, being bombed inside their homes. This is Saudi Arabia. This is the strongest allies of the United States of America. America says Saudi Arabia, our strongest allies. We have to stand with the oppressed. We have to raise our voice in anger against what is happening. We have to oppose that in whatever means, peaceful means. We have to tell the people of what is happening. This is an assault, an aggression against the humanity. Against the humanity. وَكُونَا لِلظَّالِمِ خَصْمًا وَلِلْمَظْلُومِ عَوْنًا. Sometimes this aggression takes place by ISIS, terrorists, radicals, who call themselves Muslims and they are not Muslims. And sometimes it takes place by someone who opens fire at people who go to a church to worship God in South Carolina. This is another type of terrorism and aggression. And we have to voice, we have to raise our voice in contempt to this, in rejection to this type of injustice too. And sometimes a black person in the streets being shot by a police officer in this country, this is another type of injustice we reject, we don't condone. So we have to stand with the oppressed. We have a responsibility. Sometimes you are a good writer, a columnist. Sometimes you are a reporter or a journalist. Sometimes you are a community leader. Sometimes through your civic engagements, political activism, you have to raise your voice and you have to say, this is wrong. It's unacceptable. وَكُونَا لِلظَّالِمِ خَصْمًا. Islam says, don't look at people's nationality. Do not look at their color. Since they are humans, they share a humanity with you. And this is again one of the golden axioms of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Nobody said this before him. Nobody said this sentence before him. An-nasu sinfan. Mankind are of two types. Are of two types. Imma akhun laka fi al-deen. Either a brother in faith, aw nadhirun laka fi al-khalq. If that person does not share religion with you, then he is your equal in creation. So he is also important. And you have to defend him or her. Sometimes you are under the illusion that if people are Muslims, we defend them. If they are non-Muslims, we don't care. This is wrong. This is not the message of Islam. This is not the message of Quran or Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, or Imam Ali. Islam says we stand with mankind. Ya ayyuhan nas. Very beautiful what the Quran says. It's found nowhere. This is why the United Nations, they put this verse at one of their entrances in New York. Ya ayyuhan nas, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. We created you from a single male and female. Wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabail. Through those single male and female, Adam and Eve, we made you into tribes and nations and cultures and languages and colors. Why? Why you made us into so many colors? لِتَعَارَفُ. So you recognize each other and you respect each other. That's the message of Islam. So Imam Ali alayhi salam says in Nahj al-Balagha, he says that sometimes عَدْلُ سَاعَةٍ, to incorporate justice in your life, in your life, in your ethics, to embrace justice, to implement justice, for 1 hour, one period of time, خَيْرٌ, much more rewarding, مِنْ عِبَادَةِ سَبْعِينَ سَنَةٍ قِيَامُ لَيْلِهَا وَصِيَامُ نَهَارِهَا. The result of incorporating justice in your life for 1 hour. The hour does not mean 60 minutes. Could be 1 day, could be 2 days, 3 days. An hour, period of time. It's more rewarding than worshipping God for 70 years, praying and fasting, but not siding with the oppressed. Not feeling the pain of the oppressed. Not supporting the oppressed. That does not do it. And then he says, وَجَوْرُ سَاعَةٍ, the evil doing of 1 hour. 1 hour of evil doing. أَشَدُّ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, worse. Worse. In a crime, this is worse. عِنْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ مَعَاصِي سِتِّينَ سَنَةً, than committing sins and being a disobedient for 60 years. Being doing injustice for 1 hour. Because maybe this 1 hour is going to destroy the whole family, the whole community, the whole nation. 1 hour of injustice. It has a long repercussion. If someone kills someone else, and then he comes to him and says, I'm sorry. Like this guy in Boston, the Muslim boy who was brainwashed by some twisted ideologies who consider themselves to be Muslims. 2 years ago in Boston Marathon, him and his brother, how many people they killed? How many? I don't know. I don't remember. How many people were dismembered for the rest of their life? Permanently disabled. And then he stands before the judge and he says, I'm sorry. You are sorry? Simple as that, you are sorry? You created tragedies in every family. In every family. How many mothers, how many wives, how many children lost their parents? And you are sorry for what you did? Only sorry? Sorry is not enough. Sorry is not enough. Nothing can bring life to those people who lost their lives. Nothing can bring peace to little children who lost their young parents. Sorry is not enough. There is no restitution for that. God says this is the biggest crime. I mentioned this last night. God says in chapter 5, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, من أجل ذلك كتبنا على بني إسرائيل أنه من قتل نفسا بغير نفس أو فساد في الأرض فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا ومن أحياها فكأنما أحيا الناس جميعا. An attack against one single member is an attack against the whole mankind. This is very gross. This is very unforgivable. I myself would not forgive that person, the boy who killed so many people in Boston. I would not forgive him. Allah says in the Holy Quran, وَلَكُمْ فِي الْقِصَاصِ حَيَاةٌ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. In qisas, retribution, there is existence. What does it mean? If there is no retribution, there is no existence. There is no dignity. There is no life. There is no peace. There is no peace. There has to be a lesson. There has to be a lesson for his friends in ISIS, in Al-Qaeda, in terrorist organizations. They have to be a lesson. Therefore, the Holy Quran says, implement justice in your life. Even if others do not respect justice, don't say, since this community, this country, this group, they don't follow justice, they don't respect justice, how can I deal with them with justice? God says, don't say this. The Holy Quran says, وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ. One of the most beautiful verses in the Holy Quran. Do not let the evil doing, the injustice of a group, force you to do the same to them. To do injustice to them. Don't learn from them. We don't learn bad things from others. We have to teach them good things. We have to teach them good things. If others are abusing us, we should not abuse them. وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ. We take a pride in the Shi'a school of thought. Listen to this carefully. One of the differences of the Shi'as with others is that we do not descend to lower levels of animals. We try to bring people up, to lift them up. This is why you don't see any retaliation when Shi'as being killed in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, in Iraq, in Saudi Arabia, in Kuwait just 10 days ago, in Lebanon, in other places, in Egypt. The Shi'as do not retaliate. They don't retaliate. Retaliation is not our ethics. We don't believe in retaliation. We do not believe that in repelling evil with evil. We don't believe in that. We don't believe in that. We believe in forgiveness. Personal forgiveness. However, if someone does something to a country, not to me personally, then he has to be punished. Allah says if he does something against you personally, you may forgive him. وَإِن تَعْفُوا أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. If you forgive and forego your right and retaliation, it's closer to piety. أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. Closer to righteousness. We don't retaliate. Our scholars, our imams, they say do not retaliate. Imam Ali was struck with the sword tonight. On the 40th of Hijrah, 40th year after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the Grand Mosque of Kufa, he was struck fatally with the sword of Abdurrahman ibn Muljam, a Kharijite, an ISIS-minded person. He was Muslim, used to pray and fast, and he memorized the Quran. But if you want to know about him, he's like Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the caliph of ISIS today. Someone who reads the Quran but does not understand it. Or he reads the Quran and he does exactly opposite to what God says in this book. Exactly opposite. Imam Ali said to his children, he said to his son, Bunayya Hassan, Anta waliyuddin. You are the guardian of the family after me. You are the heir. So فَلَكَ أَن تَعْفُ وَلَكَ أَن تَقْتَصُ. When you capture this person who killed me, and Imam Ali, he knew he's going to die, he said, you have the right of forgiving him or retaliating. But I advise you to forgive him. This is what he said. If you ask me personally what is my feelings, I'm telling you, forgive him. Don't retaliate. Set him free. Imam Ali says to his killer who was captured, he was in the next room. Next room. They did not send him to maximum security prison in New York City. No, he was put in the next door room. And therefore Imam Ali, when they bring a drink to him, he takes a sip and then he says, احملوه إلى أسيركم. Take the rest of the drink to him, to Abdurrahman ibn Murja. Give him good food, good drink, take care of him. Do not even frighten him. Wow. Do not intimidate him. This is Ali. This is an eternal justice. This is an eternal justice. This type of justice remains and spreads, and we get inspired by it. وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ عَلَىٰ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا. Do not allow the evil doing of others to force you to do injustice. Don't do that. اعدلوا. Always stick to justice. هو أقرب للتقوى. اعدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Says, لن تقدس أمة. لن تقدس أمة. لا يؤخذ فيها للضعيف حقه من القوي غير متعتع. Ummah, a nation who does not stand for ضعيف, the weakest among them, the oppressed among them, the abused among them, that ummah is not going to be able to move forward or to progress. Muslims have to listen to this. If we don't stand for justice and defend the oppressed, we are not going to move forward. لن تقدس أمة. غير متعتع. He says the right completely. غير متعتع, it means completely. The whole right has to go back to the one who has been oppressed. If Muslims want to lead a dignified life today, they have to stand up for justice. And justice is not only in the battlefield, neither only on the Capitol Hill. Justice is also in the family, with your children. You as a father, are you a just father to your family, to your wife, to your children? You as a mother, are you just and fair to your husband, to your children? You have a responsibility. Every father and every mother has a responsibility. Fatherhood and motherhood. To take care of our children. To raise good leaders. Today our countries, our societies, they require leaders. Inspiring leaders. We have, whether in America or outside America, we have something called lack of leadership. Lack of good leadership. This is the responsibility of the fathers and the mothers. We have to raise good children. We have to make them good leaders. Are we doing justice to our families? I received many complaints from members in the community that, please, can you address this on the podium next time when you speak? My husband is abusing me. My husband is doing this or that. And I received complaints also from men against women, and from children against their parents, and from parents against their children. There is injustice. There is injustice everywhere. We have to be just. What's the point of fasting 30 days, praying so many times a day, reciting the Quran, when our conduct is contrary to the teachings of the Holy Book? There is no point in that. There is no point. The month of Ramadan is the month of self-examination. A month of meditation. A month where we look at our conduct. We examine our relationships with people around us. Each and every person has to ask himself and herself, am I doing good to those who are next to me? Be it family members, be it friends, be it neighbors. Is my neighbor happy with me being next to him, my house next to his house? We have to ask these questions. This is a humanity. This is how we make ourselves true humans. This is how we get closer to God, my friends. Getting closer to God depends on our conduct and our behavior. God has no blood relationship, no ties, no biological ties with anyone. God says, "Inna akramakum 'inda Allahi atqakum." You do good in your family, in your community, you get close to me. You do bad, I'm away from you. Don't even call upon me. Change yourself. The night of changing is tonight. These nights. The nights of destiny. We call them destiny. The meaning of Qadr, Laylatul Qadr, where the Quran says, Inna anzalnahu fi Laylatul Qadri wa ma adraka ma Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadri khayrun min alfi. The worth of this night is more than almost 84 years, which is the lifespan of a person. If he lives in America, not Africa, huh? Not the Middle East. Almost it. God says, because this night can determine your fate and your destiny. This is the night of destiny. How do we change our destinies? Through changing ourselves. The destiny would not change. The fate would not change. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِ. Some people want to change others, but they do not change themselves. It's like America. America wants to export democracy to the Middle East, but some parts of America lacks democracy. If you ask the African American in this country, do you feel equal to others? They say no. After 250 years, we are still treated as, especially by police force, as second-class citizens, as aliens. So we have to begin with ourselves. Imam Ali says, justice begins with yourself. Never abuse yourself. How do we abuse ourselves? I give you an example. One of the ways where people abuse themselves is when they disconnect themselves from God. Disconnecting yourself from God constitutes an abuse against yourself. لا تشرك بالله إن الشرك لظلم. وإذ قال لقمان لابنه, Luqman said to his son, يا بني لا تشرك بالله إن الشرك لظلم عظيم. When you disconnect yourself from the source of love and source of compassion and source of forgiveness, you are abusing yourself. Then do not abuse your Lord. Your Lord has rights upon you. Don't abuse him. Your Lord says, listen, I'm sustaining you, I'm helping you, I'm providing you, I'm protecting you. In return, I'm asking you to listen to me on a few things. Few things. When I say don't drink this, do not drink it. When I say don't touch this, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ. If someone is an orphan, do not touch his or her wealth in order for you to abuse. Things that do not belong to you, do not touch them. Do not touch them. Whether it's money, whether it's food, whether it's a property, don't touch it. Leave it alone. The story of the Sudanese students of medicine in Ireland, popular story in Europe, was in the news. He was told one day, he went to Ireland, he comes from a poor background to study medicine, and he was sent a letter by the bank, his bank in Ireland, in Dublin, that there is whatever million euros coming to you, do you want it to be in your saving account or checking account? So he reads the letter, what? $20 million? I have nobody to send me $20 million. So he threw the letter away. And then after 1 week, there is another letter. Listen, the interest is accumulating on this amount. Where do you want us to put the check? Deposit the check in your checking or in your saving? Again, he doesn't take it serious. The third letter comes. People tell him, his friends, they tell him, listen, this is a gift. Go and take it. Go and claim it. Who cares? He goes to the bank manager and he finds it's a serious letter, serious money. The bank tells him, this is your money. He says to him, sir, my book teaches me that the money that does not belong to me, I should not touch. I don't touch that money. This money does not belong to me. 20 million euros for someone who works at a restaurant. He does dishes to help himself, to pay for his tuition. He says, the money does not belong to me. This is honesty. This is called integrity. This is a model of Islam, not ISIS. Not ISIS. This is the right model. This is the model that God cherishes and God loves and God adores. So, Imam Ali says, begin with justice, with yourself, with your Lord, and with your family members. And you all know the story of Imam Ali. I'm not going to take longer tonight. Tonight is the night of supplication and dua and getting closer to Allah. And we have another two nights, which is Tuesday, and the grand night, which is Thursday night, where we stay here until Fajr, inshallah. Salamun hiya hatta matla' al-Fajr. Imam Ali, his sibling, his brother, from his father and his mother, who was older than him too, by the name of Aqil, he comes to him and he says, I'm broke. Aqil was in Medina. Imam Ali was in Kufa, in southern Iraq, because he moved the capital from Medina to Kufa. So he travels all the way from Medina to Kufa, asking for some financial help. Imam Ali says to him, but I don't have extra money. I receive a salary from Baytul Mal. You wait until the end of the month when they give me my money, I'll give part of it to you. He says, your money? I'm not asking for your money. I want a bonus. I'm the brother of the caliph. And I have children. They are suffering. Imam Ali says, but I don't give bonuses to anyone. I give to people what they deserve. People have share in Baytul Mal in this treasury. At the end of every month, we distribute the money equally, equally. So if you want, you can wait until the end of the month. Aqil says, no, I can't. I left my family behind me and I want a bonus from you. Imam Ali said to him, I can share with you, I can help you, but don't ask me for a bonus because you are the brother of the caliph. I don't have these things. He refuses. Aqil, he leaves his brother. Imam Ali says to him, okay, I have an idea. Do you want money? Aqil says, yes, sure. He says, go to the market now in the evening, break the locks of these shops, and take whatever money you have. Aqil says to Imam Ali, do you want me to steal? Do you want me to steal from a shop? Imam Ali says to him, to steal from one is better than stealing from the whole population. Steal from one shop. Of course, Imam Ali does not want him to steal. He's giving him an example. Imam Ali is telling him that in the same way that stealing from one shop is bad and evil, taking money from the treasury to the brother of the caliph is also crime and theft. It's an act of theft. Now, how many Muslim leaders, they abide by this rule? How many? This is the justice of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Tonight, Imam Ali is in the house of his daughter, Umm Kulthum. He had two sons, and two daughters from Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. And he had other sons from other women too. But the children of Fatima were very dear and near to him. So he would spend a few nights with his children. Tonight was the turn of his daughter Kulthum, who was married, and Imam Ali was the guest, her guest at the time of Iftar. He had a house, they lived in a small house near Masjid al-Kufa, and she was supposed to bring him the Iftar. And his Iftar was very simple. أَلَا وَإِنَّ إِمَامَكُمْ قَدْ اِكْتَفَى مِنْ دُنْيَاهِ بِقُرْصَيْهِ بِطِمْرَيْهِ وَمِنْ طُعْمِهِ بِقُرْصَيْهِ. Qurs is the loaf. Two qurs, qursayh, two loaves of barley bread. That was the favorite food of Ali ibn Abi Talib during the month of Ramadan. So he broke his fast today. Tonight, the 18th of Ramadan, the year 40th, but that night was a special night for him. 38 years before this night, the Prophet was speaking about the month of Ramadan. So Imam Ali asked him, Ya Rasulullah, ما أحب الأعمال في هذا الشهر? What is the best deeds that one can do during the month of Ramadan? The Prophet answered him in one sentence. He said, Ya Ali, أحب الأعمال إلى الله تعالى في هذا الشهر الورع عن محارم الله. The best acts, the best deeds in the month of Ramadan is to abstain not only from food or drink. Not only from food and drink. To abstain from sinning, from committing a sin, committing any violation against yourself or others. Stay away from that. Self-control. This is exactly what the Holy Quran says. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Fasting has been prescribed upon you as we did with others for one reason. Self-control. Taqwa. So you control yourself against desires. You control yourself. You don't say something bad. You don't do something bad. You don't hurt someone, you don't steal, you don't lie, you don't cheat. Control yourself. Then the Prophet looked at Ali alayhi salam, and then he started weeping. Ali said to him, Ya Rasulullah, what's wrong? Why do you weep? I'm asking you a question and you answered me. He said, Yes, Ya Ali. أبكي لما يستحل من دمك في هذا الشهر. You know the reason why I am crying? This is 38 years. Before Ali's murder. This is when Ali was only 25 years old, still young. He had just married Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. He says to him, Ya Ali, I am weeping because in this month, during this month, in the future, you're going to be murdered. Someone, while you are offering units of prayers to your Lord, will strike you on your head and it drenches you with your blood. And the Prophet was weeping, so Ali asks him, imagine Ali is only 25 years old. He was not terrified. He said, أَفِي سَلَامَةٍ مِّن دِينِي يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. When he does this, when he murders me, my faith is secured, is immune, I die with faith. The Prophet says, indeed, Ya Ali, وَذَٰلِكَ فِي سَلَامَةٍ مِّن دِينِكَ. Ali says, I don't care. As long as my faith is secure, I meet my Lord with faith, with commitment, with belief, with good acts. Because everyone has to die. Today they buried a physician. His mother told my wife that my son had three specialists three times at the age of 40. Imagine, he had a future. He was supposed to live another at least 40 years. He was buried today. few hours ago. We die, we all die. We have to die. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul shall taste death. We have to be ready for it, for that moment. So Imam Ali tonight, he ate something very simple, and he had a sleepless night, and he would go and look at the stars, and he says, "Hiya, hiya, wallah, al-laylatu allati wa'adani fiha habibi Rasulullah." Yes, this is the night. This is the night where my sweetheart, the Prophet, promised me. I can say, tonight is the night. Wallahi ma kadhibtu wa la kudhibt. I never lied in my life, and my sweetheart, the Prophet, never lied to me. Tonight is the night. So he spent the night tonight, the whole night, in vigil, in prayers, in communion with his Lord, reciting the Quran, supplicating, seeking forgiveness, istighfar, praying. And before Fajr, before dawn, he prepared himself to leave the house. Imagine every night his children would act as bodyguards to their father, Hassan and Hussein, because Imam Ali had many enemies. Many enemies had threatened him. The Kharijites, they threatened him on many occasions to murder him. So Imam Hassan, who was 38 years old, and Imam Hussein, who was 37 years old, they would be his bodyguards every single night. They would not leave their father alone. Tonight, the divine planning is at work. God wants Imam Ali to go by himself to the mosque alone, because God wants him to be back to him. He wants him to be alone, without a human protection. So Imam Ali goes to the mosque. Before Fajr, he would go there. Sometimes he himself raised the adhan at the masjid. So he went, surmounted the mihrab of Masjid al-Kufa, and he raises the adhan, Allahu Akbar. His voice reverberates in the city of Kufa. Historians write that فَمَا كَانَ بَيْتٌ فِي الْكُوفَ إِلَّا وَدَخَلَهُ صَوْتُ الْإِمَامِ. All households of Kufa that night, that particular night, they were able to hear the voice of Ali ibn Abi Talib raising the adhan, adhan al-Fajr. He finished his adhan, he came down, he stood in his mihrab just by himself, alone, offering the nafilatul fajr, two rak'ah before salatul fajr, until the other Muslims, they come. They arrive, he was alone. Ibn Muljim, he stands. Abdul Rahman ibn Muljim, the Kharijites, he stands with his sword. He waits for the Imam, Ya Mu'mineen, when the Imam goes to ruku', and then he goes to sujood. Once the Imam raises his head from the sujood, Abdul Rahman ibn Muljim, he strikes the Imam on his head. Allahu Akbar. Imam says, Allahu Akbar, ala ala tahaddamat wallah arkanul huda. Imam Ali alayhi salam, the first thing he said, Fustu wa Rabbil Ka'ba. I attained success, felicity, happiness by the Lord of the house. Fustu wa Rabbil Ka'ba. He falls face down. And Jibreel cries, Ala ala tahaddamat wallah arkanul huda. The foundations of religion has been demolished today. Ala ala tahaddamat wallah arkanul huda. Wan fasamat al urwatul wuthqa. Qutila ibn Amm al Mustafa. Qutila Aliyun al Murtada. قتله أشقى الأشقياء إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين.